Alrighty. So, groundwater.
Want to go back mentally to when we discussed the water cycle. And once the water came back around, we did discuss the water cycle in here, correct? Yeah. I think so. I think so too, but as we can tell, my memory's not the best lately. You would have had a whole bunch of phase change terms, would have talked about evaporation, condensation, precipitation, deposition. Well, you guys think about it while we're talking. So, well, here, there's the picture. Have you seen that before? Okay, cool. So, think back in the water cycle to when we got to the point where the water precipitation falls back to the earth, and it does one of two things. It stays at the surface as runoff, or it percolates down into the ground as what we will call groundwater. Okay, so we're at a sort of proverbial fork in the road here. The staying at the surface as runoff is the streams. Okay, that's that conversation, which hopefully we'll get to this semester. Of course, there's lakes and ponds and whatnot involved in the meantime, but geologically speaking, we tend to focus on the streams. Lakes aren't very geologically active, so to speak. So streams. And then, of course, if the water doesn't stay at the surface and it goes into the ground, well, then that's the groundwater chapter where we're headed today. Of course, the more and more that we blacktop and pave and cover with strip malls and subdivisions and all of that stuff, we keep more water at the surface and less water going into the ground. That's part of, if you live around here, that's part of what's been going on with Sequoia Creek over the years, is that all the development upstream has left more water staying at the surface, which means more trouble downstream. I wasn't here back in the day because I was in Ohio. Y'all weren't even born yet. And possibly I wasn't even born yet to, you know, depends how old the person is talking to you. But they say that it never used to flood the way it does nowadays. So groundwater is this little part of the hydrologic cycle here. Okay. And I will look through our notes or our lectures more so and see that we did indeed talk about the hydrologic cycle. It was quite possibly very early in the semester. If not, we'll throw a little mini lesson in. Because even though a couple of you remember it, a couple more don't. So, so we're going to be on this slide for a while because there's a lot of vocabulary embedded in it, because there's just a lot to talk about, really. And what we're looking at is, well, who remembers what kind of rock symbol was the dots? Sandstone. Excellent. All right. So in this conversation, we're looking at sandstone. They quite possibly we're thinking about sediment. All right. You'll see a definition fairly soon here that when we talk about groundwater, sometimes we're talking about rock or sediment. In the context of this class, we're always going to be talking about it with regards to solid rock. And you're going to see sedimentary rocks over and over and over again, because sedimentary rocks are, well, basically they're the good rocks for groundwater. You'll hear me mention the other two briefly, but sedimentary rocks are where it's at if you're drilling a well, if you're talking about an aquifer, which is that body of groundwater, okay? So anyhow, we're looking at sandstone. And I know you guys saw sandstone in lab, and I know you stared at sandstone till you were sick of staring at sandstone. And I guarantee you, you didn't see any holes or pore spaces. I haven't in the 25 years I've been doing this myself. But you gotta believe me, they're there. All right. And so these two little squares, the blowout squares on the left-hand side there, those are sort of doing microscope zoom-in level kind of thing. And in between those little grains of sand that are glued together because they're irregularly shaped, you know, they always say that, but even if they were perfect spheres, there'd still be space in the middle of them. But at any rate, because of the randomness of the grains that are put together, there's going to be little gaps in between. And yeah, that those gaps are filled with cement, or it wouldn't be a hunk of rock, but there's still some holes. All right? And so what we're showing you here then is that those little holes, which we're going to be talking about, we're going to give you some vocabulary words for those little holes, can be filled with one of two things. Pollution aside, they're either going to be filled with water, 100%, or they're going to be filled with water and air, which I want you to really try to think of as gas instead of air, but you always end up saying air anyhow. So what that gives us then is something we call the saturated zone on the bottom, where all of that pore space, did I use that word yet, pore space? You know what pore space is, right? Where all of that pore space is filled with water, or the unsaturated zone, all right, where your pore space is filled with water and air. Now, we're going to talk about almost all of these words on here. One of them I don't want you to worry about is the vadose zone, right under the tree there, all right? When we could just put the word un in front of saturated and make a word we already know and understand, let's do that, okay? We have enough vocabulary flying at us every moment of every day. So we have the saturated zone and the unsaturated zone. So what they're saying there, even though the top is still brown, you will find some water in those pores. All right, so that's that. Separating those two is something called the water table, a solid blue line going through the diagram. First thing we want to point out is that in the real world, this is three-dimensional, right? This section of rock we're looking at comes not only goes into the board, but it comes into the room as well. So that blue line is really a surface. It's a plane, all right? The water table marks the top of the saturated zone. So it's like the last space where you would find all your pore spaces fully saturated. Now let me ask you guys, do you think that is fixed and unmoving, or do you think that can fluctuate? Yeah, it certainly does. Anybody think it's fixed? Like this is the line, right? Yeah, good. No, not at all. All right, of course. There's lots of things that could change it too, right? You've got whether or not it rains a whole lot, whether or not a whole bunch of snow just melted, whether or not it hasn't rained in 3 months. You open up a new subdivision that for some reason is using groundwater instead of city water. Whole lots of things can affect whether or not this water table goes up or down. That affects, where this conversation eventually gets to, your well or your township's well, so on and so forth. You'll often also see a little upside down triangle on the water table. That's just shorthand for hydrogeologists. Those are the folks in charge of talking about groundwater, and to some extent surface water. That's just their little symbol for the water table, an upside down triangle, oftentimes on a line as well. But so it'll tell you like a depth, something like that. So then the other thing we got here is the well. Now, I don't know if you guys have ever seen a well like this. I'm not entirely sure I've ever seen a well like this. I have seen old things boarded up, bricked up, and they're like, oh yeah, it used to be an old well there. I still don't think it was a bucket well. But they are, because, right, you know, we keep seeing in the movies little Timmy or little Susie fell down a well.
Well, there are lots of movies.
Well,
well,
and there's that. Did you have a bucket?
It looked like a mushroom, like the top of it.
Right, but you didn't have a bucket. You didn't have a crank bucket. Well, you guys were in the 19th century, not even the 20th century. Good. Yeah, no, and you won't with the modern day things. If when you've got a pump and stuff like that, of course not. So, again, I don't know where these kids are finding these things, and kids will find stuff, of course. But yeah, you know, I haven't seen one of these in except in, like, movies. And then speaking of movies, there was all those movies where these creepy children were crawling out of wells, and we want to, you know, stop that too. So most of these are boarded up nowadays. But in that case, of course, it has to be large enough for the bucket to go down, and you could probably imagine, you know, a pit down the bottom where there is a decent amount of water that you're, for lack of a better word, ladling out. I grew up with those big old black or whatever color cast iron pumps when you go to the park. Okay, we didn't have water bottles back in the day. There, I mean, Perrier was around. Evian, I don't know if Evian or Evian is still around. But, you know, you had some fancy water bottles, but not to the extent where it is today. And people sure as heck didn't have refillable water bottles. If you knew someone that was in Vietnam War, yeah, or in the Army Reserve, you might have a plastic canteen or an old metal canteen, your grandfather from World War II. But things were, like I said, we didn't carry water around like you guys did. So we had to drink out of pump wells in parks and stuff like that. So you go down, you pump on this big old well, a handle up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down. And then eventually some lukewarm, rusty water that half the time tasted like egg started coming out. All right? So I don't know what I thought was underneath that, back to the story. But I sure as heck didn't think that water was getting sucked through a rock up into the tube. And that's why I had to pump so dang hard. All right? I don't think I thought there was a big swimming pool full of water down there either. I just probably didn't think about it. But I certainly didn't think it was being sucked through a rock. But I guarantee you, that's what's going on. In her well that she talked about where they have the narrow little tube, or one of these big wells, that water's got to flow through the rocks. So going back to that conversation about looking at sedimentary rocks in lab, even the limestone, all right, there's pore spaces in there, and the water can get through it. Last but not least is capillary fringe. Not a horribly important word for us, but since it's on here, this is sort of the paper towel effect, as I call it. All right. Some of that water will trickle up into the unsaturated zone. And I'm guessing, you know, again, if you're figuring out the hydrology of the area, that might be vaguely important. But and it's been in every diagram I've ever seen in every book. So, again, it's important to somebody. But in our conversation, not so much. So here's just a recap of what we were talking about. All right, you got your saturated zone and your unsaturated zone. In the saturated zone, you only have water in the pore spaces. Or more correctly, the pore spaces are 100% full of water, ideally. In the unsaturated zone, you've got gases and water in the pore spaces, so not 100%. And then separating those two with a nice dash of blue line because it likes to move, we've got said water table. They call it a table because it is a plane, not just a line you saw in your two-dimensional diagram. I told you there were vocabulary words that we use to discuss what we've been discussing about. And they are porosity and permeability. This font that I chose doesn't really distinguish between bold and unbold very well. So the words porosity and permeability are in capitals there. I suppose I could underline them as well to make them stand out just a tad bit better. But so the first one we want to talk about is porosity. And porosity really is nothing more than a known volume of rock. Let's say you have a 1-foot by 1-foot cube of rock in front of you, okay, three-dimensional. How much of that rock is pore space and how much of it is actually rock? So that's maybe an abstract thought for some of you. So what can we talk about? Well, we can talk about something that's more than likely sitting on your kitchen sink, if not maybe in your garage somewhere, and that's a sponge, okay? And now think about that sponge, and that sponge is made up of two things. It's made up of spongy material and the lack of spongy material, or the holes, right? So thinking about that sponge, we can say that, and this is just a guess, that sponge is 70% spongy material and 30% holes. Well, we could say then that that has a porosity of 30%. 30% of that sponge is pore space. You follow? Think of a piece of Swiss cheese, not a slice, but like a big old block of Swiss cheese. Same thing could be said. You've got your cheese and you've got your place where the little air pockets are. Maybe we'd say 85 to 90% of that is cheese and 5 or 10% of it is holes or pore spaces. So that's porosity. It's just a count, and they talk about it as a percentage of the whole, okay? Now, permeability, the other term, it's equally as important. There, you know, you really can't have, you can't talk about permeability if you don't have any pore space. So, you know, pore space kind of trumps everything here, but permeability is really important, all right? Permeability is the interconnectedness of those pores. A term I've made up there at the bottom, you can spell it however you want, put a hyphen. Nowadays, I'd probably put a hyphen or two in there. But flow-throughability, okay? Flow-throughability. How well can that water move through the rock? Remember we said when you're doing that pump well, or you've got a little pump on your well at home, all right? When you're sucking on that straw, as it were, that water has to move through the rock. So this measures how well that can happen. And the answers, as you're going to find out, are not so great, pretty well, and really great. Okay? There are numbers. Okay? We're not going to get into them. Again, hydrology is another semester-long course. And you're starting to see the curse, at least, of this survey class. Is that practically every chapter we've talked about is at least its own semester class. And we just hop from topic to topic to topic. I don't think that's unique to us, but it is definitely a curse of intro geology. So, anywho, permeability and porosity are two characteristics that we would use to describe, next vocabulary word, an aquifer. I know I skipped a slide. We'll get back to it in a second. All right, so what we've been talking about are aquifers. An aquifer is a body of rock or sediment that gives up water. Now, this is where I fluctuate from your book a little bit. All right. I'm saying that an aquifer, if you're calling a rock an aquifer, you are implying that it has a good porosity and a good permeability. We wouldn't be calling it an aquifer if it sucked, okay? Pardon my French, but, and pardon the potential pun there. But there's no point, right? Unless you have zero other options and you're stuck using a really crummy block of rock. We wouldn't be talking about it if it didn't give you water. So, because you're going to see some, like, half kind of aquifers here in a minute or two. And the book presents them just as that, is that, well, this is an aquifer, but it's a really crummy aquifer, so we're still going to give you a vocabulary word for it. I prefer to twist that a little bit and say, these are examples of when even a sedimentary rock would not be a great example. So let's go back a moment to that slide we skipped. The print is way too small for you guys to see, especially on this screen. But the top half here lists different types of sediment. As I'm sure you can imagine, sediment is much more porous and much more permeable than a rock. Okay. If you have a swimming pool at home and your folks or your family over the couple years is tired of replacing those paper filters in there, you might have moved up to something called a sand filter. All right, if you've got a good built-in pool, whether it's in-ground or above-ground, You probably had a sand filter from the start. That is just way better. Okay, sand is a great filter. In order for that to work, of course, water's got to be able to flow through it. So sediment, again, kind of goes without saying. And we're not going to worry about sediment here. We're talking about rocks. So we got conglomerate, that's a sedimentary. We got sandstone, that's a sedimentary. We got shale, that's a sedimentary. Remember what I told you, sedimentary rocks make good aquifers. But let's look at some of those numbers you can't really see there. Their porosities, sometimes they go down to 10%. So there's not a whole lot of pore spaces in there. Sometimes they could go up to 30. There's a limestone down there that says up to 50, but it also has the word cavernous in front of it. So that means there's giant pockets. So that's obviously going to up your percentage. Going back to some of the things that help make this matter, I babbled earlier about the shape of the grains. Remember that? But think about last time you played pool, or if you've ever seen anybody play pool. And, you know, one of the important things about playing pool, especially if you just lost the previous game, it's your turn to rack. At least those were the rules back in my day. No matter how tight you make that, there's always going to be those little spaces in between because the balls are spheres, right? And that's where that pore space comes from. Now, you stack multiple levels of those balls in there. You add the randomness of Mother Nature's weathering and erosion. You know, you're going to get less and less pore space as you go through there. But that's the idea. And you see that we see the most potential porosity with the well-sorted, low-cemented sandstone. So everything's the same size. There's no little bits and pieces filling in the holes and so on and so forth. So anywho, not to belabor that. Crystalline rock. Could be igneous, could be metamorphic. Very low porosity, generically speaking, okay? And volcanic rock, again, igneous. Yeah, sure. Pumice has a lot of holes in it. That's an exception. When we talk about, in a little bit, we're going to talk about some folks with granite aquifers. Okay? Because folks with granite aquifers love to talk about their granite aquifers. But remember how igneous rocks grow, right? They crystallize bit by bit out of a pool of magma or a flow of lava. There's not a way for air pockets to form there. Again, with the exception of the pumice or the scoria, don't get me wrong, because those are really gassy and they leave pockmarks behind. But generally speaking, that's a solid, tight rock. Now, moving to the other column, permeability. All right. Again, your sediments are way more permeable for the most part than any of the rocks. Again, that's because they're not lithified. There's no glue in the way. But we see our sand, our sedimentary rocks over and over again to be the best of permeability. Glaring exception is shale. Shale, if you recall, is made out of silts and clays. Silts and clays, clay in particular, has a very special property. It's called hydrophilic. You might not know the suffix philic, but you're familiar with the opposite of it, phobic. What does phobic mean? A scared of it, right. All right, don't like it. Hydrophobic would be water repelling nowadays, they would say. Hydrophilic is water loving. And it's something to do with the size of the molecule, the size of the clay particle, a handful of things play into it. But, oh my goodness, clay-sized particles in water is again, going back to, you know, like a sponge. It sucks it right up. But it does not like to let it go. And it holds on to it. So we see the permeability of shale as being very, very low, even though it might list a semi-decent porosity there. Okay? In fact, in these diagrams we're going to start talking about in a couple minutes, we talk about shale as sort of a like Tupperware. It's just a bottom layer. Nothing's getting through it. It's an impermeable layer, a Ziploc baggie, whatever terminology you want to use there. Even though it is sedimentary. So anyhow, you could have an aquifer made out of any of these types of rocks or a combination therein. Remember, rocks can layer themselves, you know, different types in there. So as I said, your book will go on to talk about some other types of aquifers. And the first of which is something called an aquitard. Aquitard, they're using the term retard in there. Now, what does to retard mean? We're not using it as a noun. We're using it as a... Thank you for the giggles. What did you say?
To lift up?
No. No, actually almost the opposite of that. To retard means to do what? It means to slow. Flame retardant. You may have heard of that. All right? It is not flame resistant. There's a big difference. I learned this... I didn't learn it the hard way, thank God, but I learned this back when I was buying children's pajamas, which you guys probably haven't done yet. There's a difference between flame resistant and flame retardant, and my wife and I had that conversation, and what it boils down to is flame retardant is you will still burn, you'll just burn very slowly. So flame resistant is a bit more, and can you believe they do that with children's pajamas? It's just horrible to even think about. But at any rate, retard means slow, okay? And that's where we do get into the noun that we don't use that word anymore, of course. But that's where it came from. It's a slowed process. So an aquitard is a layer of rock or sediment that yields water very slowly, all right? That is low permeability. There's water there. There's plenty of holes there. But they're arranged in such a way that... you can't get the water out. One of the conversations we typically have is, let's go back to the sponge and the Swiss cheese that we talked about a couple minutes ago. So your sponge, you got a brand new sponge, you're holding it up under the sink and we're letting it fill up with water, and slowly but surely you can feel that sponge start to get wet in your hand, and then before you know it, the water's dripping out the bottom. Okay? It has traveled all through that sponge. Fairly permeable. However, if you hold a big block of Swiss cheese up underneath your spigot and turn on the water, most likely it's going to splash everywhere like those lovely lab sinks do in the lab room, okay? Because while there are holes in that cheese, and it arguably may be just as porous as the sponge, those holes aren't connected. I can't imagine you've ever tried to blow through a chunk of Swiss cheese, but if you did, it's not going anywhere. Those holes aren't connected. Okay, so water isn't going to flow through them very well at all. So that's an example of where we're headed with this, and how porosity and permeability can be similar but quite different results in the end. Aquiclude is even worse than an aquitard. Clude is an exclude. Okay, this is a layer of rock or sediment that yields little to no water. More than likely a very low permeability or possibly a low porosity, but this goes back to my argument that I premised this with. Why would you even be calling it an aquifer in the first place? Okay. So, you know, it's just a silly little thing that they do. Sometimes as a hydrologist, you have to pick the lesser of the evils. Okay. Kind of like boating sometimes. And, you know, you've got to drill water somewhere. So which of these are your best choice? In here, we're going to talk about an aquiclude, again, as like shale, that impermeable layer. All right, speaking of which, we're going to see some diagrams here in a minute. And we really, just to keep the conversation simple, again, remember we get one or two lectures on this, not an entire semester. We're going to focus on two ways to make an aquifer. One of them is called a confined aquifer, and the other one is called an unconfined aquifer. We're going to talk about unconfined first, even though it's at the bottom of the list here. An unconfined aquifer is basically probably what you just saw in the well picture a little bit ago. All right, you've got the grass and the soil at the top. If it rains, it's going to trickle down in. It's going to fill up this aquifer. And you're probably wondering, well, what stops the water? At some point, there is a confining layer. It usually doesn't make it into the diagrams, right? So we're going to say that an unconfined aquifer only has that confining layer, that impermeable layer, at the bottom of it. It has a bottom on the... Again, you have to picture these kind of in your head. So picture a big section of rock, and you've got a bottom to your bowl, a bottom to your swimming pool, whatever image you're pulling up here. Whereas a confined aquifer, on the other hand, a confined aquifer has a lid on it as well. And you might be thinking, okay, if there's a lid on it, how the hell do I get the water in there? And you're absolutely right. It's a lot harder. There is a benefit to it. There's a really great benefit to it, but it's really hard to get water back in it. So this is what you're seeing here about recharging, okay, refilling. They call it recharge. But it's filling it back up. It's that rain trickling down in and going back into the ground. The unconfined aquifer, as we said, obviously it's really easy because it can just do that. But on a confined aquifer, it's got to find a gap or a break in that lid in order to refill that aquifer. As I said, you're going to see some pictures. It makes it a lot easier to understand. In a minute, unfortunately. Sometimes you really start to question the order of your slides. So this would be, and I did actually finally label it down here. You see it in pink in the bottom left-hand corner there. This would be a decent example of an unconfined aquifer. Again, you could not see the bottom layer in this diagram. It's unimportant. It is presumed that there's one somewhere or the water wouldn't be filling up above it, right? So just like in our previous diagram, you've got a hole in the ground. It goes down. That's your well. And you could imagine that if it rained anywhere up on that hill, sort of running down the hill, which of course some of the water will do, the water will trickle down into the rock and fill up that water table. Unless, what's that black dashed stuff? What rock was that? Tire track looking stuff there. You guys had four rock symbols to remember for this class. And this is the chapter why you had to do it. We already said that the dots was what? Sandstone. So the dash of black lines, somebody else help us? No, that's bricks. We'll see that in a couple minutes. Yeah, that's shale. All right, we're running out of rocks, right? It's all right. Yeah, this is shale. And again, it looks like shale, sort of. First of all, it's black, right? And the dashed lines are supposed to indicate the whole broken up nature of shale, the layered nature of shale. So anyhow, what did we just tell you guys about shale? We told you that shale is sort of an impermeable layer. It's Tupperware. So when you get shale in the rock, it's going to catch the water. And as they're showing you here, it's going to let the water actually build up on top of it. And that's fine. You know, it happens. What are you going to do about it? Where it becomes a problem is if you're someone like me and you hire the cheapest contractor to do the job all the time. I do this. I never learn. 20 years of owning a house now, and I still hire the cheapest guy. So you get Billy Bob. You know, anyone here has a relative named Billy Bob, right? I don't want to demean anybody's name, but it's a stereotypical kind of name there. All right, we got Billy Bob's well service coming in, and he says, I'll do that for $100 for you, sir. And everyone else is like $1,000. I'll be like, you know, so I'll definitely hire this guy. And it's hard to tell scale on here, but let's say that he's drilled down pretty deep. And he says, well, sir, we've had water for a good 100 feet, 200 feet of water. You should be just fine. And this is that first well up on top of the hill there. All right. But little do I know that my neighbor, a few miles down the road, their well's like 900 feet. So I just paid this guy, came out here, did all this stuff, and yeah, he hit water, but he hit a what we call a perched water table. All right, it's a false water table. It's another word for it. And I'm going to run out of water, aren't I? Well before my neighbors do. So, a couple things here. One, again, I know you guys, you know, you're the age bracket here. You're not going out and buying land and drilling a well. But your folks or your family members or somebody you know might be sometime soon. Well records are public knowledge. They're public record, I should say. You just simply have to go to the township office, city, wherever. Usually cities have municipal water, but townships, county, and you have access to the well records. If you're drilling a well, make sure your well is at least as deep, if not deeper, than all the other wells around you. Okay? And pay that extra money to make sure that happens. Any reputable person obviously should be able to do this. I've given you a, you know, an educational example, so to speak. But, because again, that water table moves, doesn't it? We talked about that very early in this conversation. Now, great example of this. You guys remember Nirvana Water? I can't remember how long it's been gone. When we first moved here, the Nirvana Water plant had recently opened up. It's up north of here. And Nirvana Water, bottled water was everywhere. Absolutely everywhere. And it was super cheap because they had to drive it all of, you know, 15 miles to get it here. Could even beat Pepsi and Cokes, whatever, Aquafina and the other guy. It was everywhere. Well, come on the news. Again, we had just moved here. We'd come from Baltimore, and before that, we were from out in the Midwest, so we didn't know nothing from nothing about over here. Everybody was up in arms. Completely freaking out. They were talking about suing these guys, so on and so forth. It had been a sheep farm. Up until Aquafina, up until Nirvana bought it, okay? And this is out in farmland. The plant's still up there. I forget what company it is. We just drove by it like a month or so ago. It's another company now. I don't see the water anywhere, though. So they're maybe shipping it out of town. But sheep, you know, use a decent amount of water. You got to water your sheep. You got to wash your sheep. I don't know, maybe. I don't think farmers wash their sheep, but point being, sheep don't use a whole hell of a lot of water. But you put in a water factory, they use a lot of water. What happened was all of the surrounding properties, their water table dropped immensely, and a lot of these places apparently started sucking air. Okay, if you are in a well, you know what I'm talking about. You turn on your spigot, and it goes, then the water does come out. They were freaking out, worried that they were going to lose, you know, one of their commodities that they did have going for them. I don't know where the lawsuit went, so on and so forth. Like I said, Nirvana did eventually disappear, but somebody else is up there now. So this is a fixed, you know, resource, so to speak. But that water table can move. Same thing could happen if they put in a subdivision or you know, a trailer park or something like that that would be pulling off of wells. You can very easily affect that water table, even in an unconfined aquifer situation like this, where it is easy to refill. All right, last thing we want to talk about is a spring. We have not had the surface water conversation in here, but most of you did the lab where we looked at the topo map, and you might have spent some time trying to find something on that map called a stream, because I asked you to measure the longest stream. And then finally I said, oh, no, don't. You could use a creek if you want to. You could use a river. That's fine. In geology, we just call everything a stream to get around the whole size implication, right? Because a brook or a creek or a river, they all sort of in your head mean different sizes. We don't care about that. Well, there's one exception to that rule, and that's when we use the word spring. A spring is groundwater leaking out at the surface. All right, and these perched water tables are a great way to do that. Whether you realize it or not, you guys have been seeing this all your life anytime you get on the thruway and drive towards Albany. Most recognizable in the winter where there's those beautiful blue ice flows coming out of the side of the cliff there around Little Falls. All right, every one of those is at a shale layer. So that water trickles down through the breaks in the rocks, or it's all shale, in all honesty. So what you're looking at is a more solid shale layer. So the water trickles through all the rocks above it, it hits that impermeable layer, it fills up, and then everything runs off the side of it. Nowadays, springtime, you drive by, if you're lucky enough to catch, you'll see the little waterfalls here and there. All right, but you could really see them in the winter, because whatever's in there, the minerals it's seeping out, it makes these beautiful blue ice flows there. Very cool stuff. So a spring, at any rate, is the one exception to our, we call everything a stream rule. And when you buy bottled water, if it says spring on it, spring water, it is supposed to be coming straight out of an aquifer, not out of a river or a stream, or let alone a municipal. Like, I think it might have been Aquafina we were looking at the other day. It's like St. Louis Municipal Water Supply. They're literally buying water out of a tap from St. Louis, Missouri. And I'm not trying to slander here. It's Aquafina. Read them next time you guys. Anybody got a bottle today? Yeah. Sam's purified. Let's see. Yeah. Pittsfield, Massachusetts, municipal supply. Okay, you're paying for tap water. I paid for tap water. We got tap water here. But the stuff that says spring, the stuff you might be paying $1 more, 50 cents for more for. All right, if it says spring water on it, it damn well better, I think even by law, have to be groundwater that leaks out at the surface. All right, so unconfined aquifer versus, well, looky there. Remember that dashed line we said was shale? So now we have a lid, as I said, on that aquifer, which is going to make it really hard for any rain or melting snow. It's just going to go right down that hill, right? With the exception of that little bit of sandstone up at the top there. And it actually says area of recharge, because that is the only area that that water could get back into the aquifer. The only way you can refill the aquifer. And it sounds like a big pain in the butt, and you're like, okay, why would we even want to do this? Well, A, sometimes you have no choice. But B, and more so the reason, is because of what's going on downhill there. Okay? When you have a capstone, even though there's not something, again, to take this three-dimensionally into the board or three-dimensionally into the classroom here, even though there's not two more sides on this, it effectively acts like a pipe. You've got a top and a bottom. That water is flowing through there like pipes in your house. That makes it pressurized. Additionally, we've got the elevation change here. All right, and that elevation change even adds more pressurization. This is the reason that you see water towers are up in the air. Okay, it's to provide that flow, that dip. And here is where, again, hydrology gets a little weird. They call this head, okay? And you have lots of uncomfortable discussions about good head and bad head, but that's geologists for you. So head is the difference in elevation. So up at the top where it says area of recharge, that would be head one. And down at the bottom where the well is, that is head two. And then you get the difference in head and all kinds of, as I said, weird conversations about head. It is that difference in head that gives you the pressure. Now, as I said, I've been talking about this for 25 years, and technology, as it will do, has changed over those 25 years. You guys today have the potential, because your cell phones, many of you, have a slow motion feature that we could only dream about having back in the day. So here's what I'm going with here. That red dashed line, all right, which is sloping slightly. What this whole conversation about head tells us is that if you poke a hole downhill for a moment, ever so briefly, but for a moment, that water should shoot up as high as the top as head one. Head two should reach head one. It should equalize. And then it flows. Really hard to capture that up until nowadays. So, here's how you can do that. And here's how you can make maybe $5 in the process, a little bet, if you like to make bets. So you can simulate this very, very easily. You need a length of tubing, you need a funnel, and you need a liquid. And you're going to want to attach the tube to the funnel, and you're going to need a helper for this experiment, or for this magic trick, whatever you want to call it. And you're going to want to hold it like this. You're going to funnel in one hand, kind of like Statue of Liberty here. In a minute, you're going to raise it up. But and then you're going to have your other hand, and you put your thumb over the tube. You have your assistant fill up this funnel and this tube with liquid. And if you take your thumb on and off a little bit, you'll allow, you know, if you put keep your thumb there, you can't fill up all the way. So you got to let some air in here and there. And you get this whole thing filled up. All right, now many of you can tell me, maybe just from watching Bill Nye or something like that, talking about Statue of Liberty, you hold this up here, and you got to keep your thumb on the other end of the tube because what will happen? Yeah, the water will come right out. Now, this is what I was talking about with your cell phone cameras. The idea is that if you hold this up and you have your thumb on here, if you lift your thumb off, that water should reach the top of the funnel. You should be able to capture that these days. I wouldn't place your bet on that one yet, though. All right, I'll tell you in a minute. But that's the idea. So you do this, you do that, you've created a difference in head, you release the blocker there, and that funnel drains out, okay? Here's where you make your $5. You then tell your friend, say, I bet you I could take my thumb off of here and no water will come out. How would you make that happen? What's up? Or you lower the other, okay, if you want to have both hands in the air, you could do that, but you could also just lower the funnel, right? You get rid of head. You get rid of your elevation difference. And if you do it just right, you take your thumb off, that water's not going anywhere. Okay? And you win, like I said, $5 maybe. But you gotta have a lot of fun playing with the other thing first to distract the people that it's gonna, you know, do this and that. And then you bet them that you can't, that you can do it without it flowing. So this is called an artesian well. You've probably never seen one of these with water. You might have seen if you watch like old West movies, okay? When they poke a hole and they go, woohoo, we struck oil, strike it rich, black gold, Texas tea. Oil wells tended to do this. They'd sprout up, and again, in the old cowboy movies, you'd see everyone dancing around in the oil. But there are wells like this. They're pressurized. We don't need the pump that we were talking about a little while ago. You don't need that bucket to go down in the hole. What you need is a lid on it, a nozzle, and then you've got pressurized water. So that's why, even though they are a pain in the butt to refill, confined aquifers are actually really, really nice. It's self-flowing. And again, that's because of the confining layer on top. All right. Back to pump wells. So pump wells are fine, and we don't have a whole lot of artesian wells around there, so most of us have to deal with pump wells. If you have well water, you more than likely have a pump somewhere. Around here, you guys need to keep them inside. You go out in the Midwest and even a little further than that, they can be outside next to the well. You'll oftentimes see a little doghouse. One of the places we lived, I could never figure that out. It was an old farmhouse, and there was this doghouse in the front yard, and there was obviously no dog anywhere around. So when I asked the landlord one day, and he just chuckled at me, he's like, you're a geologist? You tell me what's in there. I'm like, a dead dog? I don't know. There's no dog anywhere to be. He's like, that's where the pump well is. Oh, Okay.
They don't have to worry about it freezing so much, so they can keep the pumps outside. The downside to a pump is if you've got a pump, you better have a generator too. Because when the power goes out, you're not getting any fresh water. You get what's in your pipes and then it's gone. So there's a lot to think about. Again, you guys aren't in a position yet where you're out buying property more than likely. But, you know, being out in Mother Nature sounds great and everything. Just keep in mind, you're going to have well water. You're going to have septic more than likely, because you don't get one without the other. You don't get sewer without water or vice versa. Usually there's exceptions. Sometimes they'll run water, but not sewers. But at any rate, you then need to think about the grid out there, and you need to be prepared to have a generator too. Otherwise you're not going to have running water. So that's not the point of the conversation. The point of the conversation is, this thing here called Kona depression. All right. And this goes back to our conversation about permeability. And we're going to talk about this farmhouse that I just told you about that I lived on for a little while. It was an old farmhouse, and it was split into three apartments. We had a top floor, and there were two apartments down below us. Also out on the property were two elderly couples, each living in a trailer. And we were all on the same well. We were all on the same septic. And on any given day, you couldn't tell. There was apparently enough permeability, enough porosity. And again, he couldn't have developed it if he did it, you know, legit, got permits and stuff like that. People would have checked. He couldn't have developed those apartments if they didn't have it. But, you know, it was the 90s. Things were a little different. Any given day, things were fine. Come to the holidays, though, one of the people downstairs had company. Somebody in the trailer had company. We had company. Toilets flushing more. The sink's going more. Maybe you're doing more laundry. You start to suck air. More use on it. And what's happening is that you're using more water. You're using water faster than it could fill back into that pore space. What it creates is something called a Kona depression around it. It cleans out around that pipe first. Now, again, this is something you guys are familiar with if you've ever bought a slush puppy or a squishy or whatever you freezy, whatever you guys call them these days. All right? So think about it. It's summertime. It's super hot out. You get that there slushy, and you're drinking it, and all of a sudden you start sucking air. And you're like, wait a minute, this thing is full. Like, my hand's still cold. I feel that. It's obviously still ice in there. You take a lid. You shake it. Oh, I got to clear it out around the straw. You got to shake everything back into place. Okay? You've all done it. You might not have paid any attention to it whatsoever. This summer, hopefully you will. You created a Kona depression. That straw works the same way that the pump does. And it's going to suck, what? The stuff around it first. So it's a matter of how permeable, in this case, how quickly the rest of that ice is going to melt to flow back in around that straw. So you do a couple things. You'll move your straw around, you poke it, you do this, you do that. Some of you might shake it. We have our own ways of fixing our slushies. And this happens, though, you can't do that. You just got to wait. Okay? You just got to wait. And it will eventually percolate back in, trickle through, whatever word you want to use, and it'll fill back in. So pump wells, one of the problems is it can create what they call a cone of depression. You shouldn't have that problem in the artesian well, the other kind of well, the self-flowing well. They could run out of water, though. Now, I've been telling you all kinds of stories here, and maybe vocabulary words have been going under the radar here. And also some of the inferences and the perks and benefits here, and also the downsides. There are a handful of questions clustered together on the test, okay, about the difference between the confined versus the unconfined aquifers, the wells that you can get out of them. So please, when it comes time to study for this last test, make sure you check on this stuff. Okay, because it's easy to get lost and fade out during my boring stories. Well, I'm telling you for a reason about them, but nonetheless, the test questions aren't about my stories, per se. They're about, you know, the moral, if you would. So, just make sure you got that down, okay? Because it's at least 4 questions, and that's half a letter grade right there, so.
Pay attention to this stuff when you're studying.
Oh, and lo and behold, I made a summary slide about it. It must be important. So artesian wells are self-flowing. They're self-flowing because they're pressurized, and they're pressurized because they're in a confined aquifer, which means it has a capstone. I didn't put another bullet. A pump well, on the other hand, is not under pressure. So I didn't put, you know, pump, but obviously it's in the name. You've got to pump it. You've got to pump it because it's not under pressure. It's not under pressure because it is an unconfined aquifer. And it is an unconfined aquifer because it does not have that capstone. Gabish, we good? So, like I said, believe it or not, I managed to turn that into like 3 or 4 questions. Kind of like when we belabored the point about igneous rocks and their crystallization and that stuff. Remember that series of long, horrible questions? Same idea. And you guys have access to these slides. Okay. So, springs. More about springs. We don't really need to know too much more about springs. I just want to reiterate as a separate vocabulary word here. Make sure you realize that. All right. When we say the word spring, we're talking about a stream that is formed by an aquifer that is intersecting. A water table intersects with the topography. All right, is another way to talk about it. Now, don't confuse this. What would we call it if the water table literally was the surface of the earth, not just leaking out at one point and making a little stream, but just say the whole damn water table for something as big as the quad here, for example, was at the surface. What would that be? Would it be wet or would it be dry? It would be wet, yeah. And if it was really wet, we might call it a well, you guys are sleepy today, but at least you came to class. Well, yeah, I know, and other people could be helping. There's not like there's not 10 other people sitting here. Yeah, and it depends. I know, I'm fishing for vocabulary words here. Yeah, it depends, all right? If it's a grassy area and it's not that, I was looking for pond or lake. Yeah, no, that, please don't apologize. Yeah, that's what's going on when you have a lake, okay? Depending on the size, you might call it a pond, whatever. A puddle, puddles are temporary, but that's why you have puddles, okay? Your water table is either at the surface or the permeability is so slow that it, or you got so much rain that it's overcoming the permeability, that water has to sit there for a little while. But if it's there for days, you got yourself a pond. Now, he mentioned a marsh, okay, or a swamp. Certainly that happens over time as well. If we change things, we get much more water staying at the surface. An area that maybe used to be a field can become exceptionally wet. That's a marsh. An area that used to be wooded. That's the difference between marshes and swamps, by the way. Swamps are woody. An area that used to be wooded. If you've ever gone past Syracuse on 90, 90 is a great example of a lot of things. Yeah, it has some nice views. But out there past what is it? Hiawatha Reserve Refuge out there, you're going to see a lot of really dead-looking trees, or at least very unhappy looking trees, okay? They flooded that area on purpose, don't get me wrong, but that also happens in nature sometimes as well. So there's a lot of different things we can talk about with the water table at the surface, but this is a groundwater conversation. So this is just a handful of different ways that springs can form. You don't really need to worry about them, other than please be sure you do know the difference between a spring and all the other streams that are out there. Speaking of streams, See, we said we weren't going to talk about streams, and that's an awful lot of talking about streams. Sometimes a stream runs dry. On a map, they usually call that an intermittent stream. It's not like a wiggly blue line, but it's a wiggly dashed blue line. You might have found one when you were working on the topo map, or at least seen the symbol. Well, and here they call that a losing stream. That's on the right. And what's happening is that stream is not connected with the water table. It's above the water table. And as such, it can lose through this very same process as the groundwater enters the water enters the ground. It's constantly losing water to the ground. How do we usually fill a stream? What are the sources of water for streams? Rain, and somebody else give us another one. Runoff. All right. Snow melt, for example, right? If a whole bunch of snow melts, runoff is a generalized term we'll use again if we do the streams chapter for all the loose water running around at the surface there. But generally speaking, we talk about snow melt or we talk about precipitation. And I know snow is a precipitation, but it's not immediate. So in the spring, you're going to see a lot of water entering the ground. So anywho, so that's our typical ways we fill streams, all right, is through runoff, which is precipitation-based primarily and seasonally snowmelt. Well, if the stream is lucky, it's also connected to the water table, and that helps keep a little bit of water in there no matter what's going on at the surface. Now, mind you, yes, the water table is a function of how much precipitation you get. It's not quite as simple as we're portraying it. So a gaining stream is always being fed by the water table. And again, you see that blue line in each of the diagrams. The blue line dissects the stream there on the left, and it's well below it on the stream on the right. Okay? So a losing stream loses water to the water table. A gaining stream is fed not just by precipitation and snowmelt, but by the water table as well. And this is getting very close to where we started the other day. Did we talk about this little old man at subsidence the other day? That's what I thought. All right. So that ends part one of groundwater.
Where's my mouse? There's my mouse.